So if you just try to look at the beam here, so the beam has two loads and three possible reactions. They are nothing but vertical reaction at A, horizontal reaction at A, and vertical reaction at B. And we are trying to determine the reactions, the three reactions, using the equilibrium equations. So unless you try to calculate these reactions, it is not possible for you to analyze the structure. Now the very first thing that we do is apply the equilibrium equations, try to calculate the unknown external forces. In this problem, we have only three unknown external forces, that is VA, HA and VB. We can calculate all these three forces using the three equilibrium equations. So once you calculate these three unknown forces, the next step would be to calculate the internal forces in the beams. That is nothing but the bending moments and shear force, and the deformations, that is the translations and rotations at any point in the beam. So this is the how we try to use the equilibrium equations to calculate the unknowns. Now let us understand what is a determinate structure. As the title of the course suggests, it says analysis of indeterminate structures. In the last presentation, we have defined what a structure is. We have said what are the different types of structures, and when you subject them to loads, okay, they develop internal forces, and the way you try to calculate them is about analysis. Analysis is about calculating the internal forces and deformations in the structure. Okay, so analysis, structure, now we are talking about determinate. Okay, now we call structures as determinate structures if it is possible for you to analyze the structure using only equilibrium equations. Okay, now the meaning that you need to understand here very clearly. Okay, so when you just talk about analyze, my final objective would be to calculate the internal forces and the deformations. Unless you know all external forces acting on the structure, that is loads and reactions, it is not possible for you to calculate the internal forces and deformations. Okay, the first step would be obviously to calculate the unknown external forces, that is nothing but the support reactions. And in case of plane structures, okay, so if the number of unknowns are maximum three, two-dimensional structure, I have three equilibrium equations, I can determine all those things, okay, all the three reactions. Okay, and that will lead us to calculate the internal forces, shear force and bending moment, and the deformation, which is nothing but the deflection and the rotation. Now if you just try to, if it is possible to do all these things with the help of equilibrium equations alone, yeah, definitely we are going to call that structure as, okay, a determinate structure. Now examples would be simply supported beams, trusses, frames, portal frames. Okay, if they are simply supported, so obviously there would be only two supports you are talking about in this exercise. It could be a simply supported beam, it could be a simply supported truss, or it could be a simply supported portal frame. There would be two supports. Okay, one essentially should be a hinge and the other one should be a roller. So if you have such a beam or a truss or a simple portal frame, okay, just one bay, right, one story, we can call it to be a determinate structure. Now the other determinate structure that you can think of is a cantilever beam, a cantilever truss, or it could be a cantilever portal frame, simple portal frame. Now I hope all of you know that in case of cantilever structures, there is beams, there is only one support, that's nothing but a fixed support. Number of reactions would be 3, vertical reaction, horizontal reaction and a moment. Coming to a cantilever truss, we will have 2 supports, one is again a hinge and another is a roller, because in truss we cannot have fixed supports, all supports are pin connected. So in case of cantilever truss, the supports would be at on one side, okay, and the truss would be supported at 2 points, one would be a hinge and other is a roller, okay. So it could also be a vertical portal frame, okay, where one of the support is a fixed support. So please understand, when you say determinate structure, this is basically statically determinate structure. There are only 2 arrangements that is possible. One is a simply supported arrangement having 2 supports, one is a roller and another is a hinge, and the other one is a cantilever support, okay. So only 2 kind of arrangement are possible in case of determinate structures. Now coming to indeterminate structures, when these structures cannot be analyzed using only equilibrium equations, then we call such structures as indeterminate structures. So I did tell you, analyze means we are trying to calculate, final objective is to calculate the internal forces and the deformations in the structure. To calculate that, you should first calculate the support reactions, obviously, right. Now why can't we do this in most of the structures? Because the number of reactions are many, it is more than the number of equilibrium equations, okay. We just try to look at huge structures, okay, the supports, there are many supports in a structure, huge structure, okay, or a continuous beam, many supports are present, and at all these supports you have the support reactions. So obviously the number of support reactions will exceed the number of equilibrium equations, because the number of unknown support reactions exceed the equilibrium equations. You cannot calculate these support reactions with the help of only equilibrium equations. Since you cannot calculate, you cannot go further and analyze a structure. We call these kind of structures as indeterminate structures. Now what do we do in such situations? Okay, so we normally think of using additional equations, okay, which will be used along with the equilibrium equations, okay, to solve the problem. So the number of compatibility equations that we have to think here depends on the problem. For example, if you have a problem where there are totally 6 reactions, we are talking about a plane structure, I already have 3 equilibrium equations, so 6 unknowns, I have to think of formulating 3 extra equations, and I try to formulate that using the compatibility conditions of deformation, provided I am following force based method of analysis, right. So totally I get 6 equations, 6 unknowns, I solve and try to get the values. Now there is also one more way in which we can try to solve indeterminate structures, that is by displacement method. In case of displacement method, we try to think of formulating additional equations beyond the equilibrium equations in terms of equilibrium conditions of forces at joints, okay. So for example, if you have a joint, okay, for example 2 members meeting at a joint, okay, the algebraic summation of the moments at the joints of the 2 members should be equal, okay, should be 0. That means the sum of the moments, central moments at the joint should be equal to 0. For example, that is joint B, so I am going to say MBA plus MBC equal to 0. Okay, so that's how I apply my equilibrium condition, okay, for forces at the joint. So I have to think of writing quite number of equations, okay, beyond the equilibrium equation, so that I have enough number of equations, okay, to solve the number of unknowns. So you need to remember that, okay, in case of indeterminate structures, you have 2 choices. That is, either you can solve the problem by force based method of analysis or displacement based method of analysis, Okay, in case of force-based method of analysis, we normally try to make use of compatibility conditions, okay, to get additional equations. And in case of displacement method of analysis, we try to make use of equilibrium condition for forces at joints to get additional equations. So the basic difference between force method and displacement method, when we write a force displacement relation, okay, we try to make the force as the independent variable, whereas in case of displacement based method of analysis, when we write relations for force and displacements, we try to make displacements as the independent variables. Now, just to make you understand quickly a compatibility condition for deformation, I have just tried to take a very simple example here. So, the first figure that you are trying to see, that is one at the top, is nothing but a cantilever beam with a support, okay, at the right side, okay, that is a prop. We also call this support as prop, and we call this beam as a propped cantilever beam. We call it as a propped cantilever beam, a cantilever beam, okay, which is supported, propped, okay, it's a propped cantilever beam. Okay, now we just try to check the degree of static indeterminacy of this. Okay, it is 1. Okay, so please understand, this is a fixed support. Okay, we'll assume there are three reactions here: vertical reaction, horizontal reaction, and a moment. Okay, that's a roller support. There is one vertical reaction here. So totally, there are 4 reactions that we have in this particular problem. Okay, and if you just try to think of equilibrium equations, it is 3. Okay, so 4 minus 3 is 1. This beam is statically indeterminate degree 1. Okay, so if you just try to quickly look at how we do this particular problem, okay, in force based method of analysis, okay, we try to remove the reaction, okay, at B, so that the structure becomes a cantilever. So we just try to look at the second figure here. Okay, this is a cantilever beam without that prop. Okay, so we apply the given load on the beam. Beam deforms. Okay, there is some amount of deflection happening here at point B. Okay, so we take the same beam with that deflected shape, and then we try to apply a force reaction, that is a reaction at B, okay, upwards, to see that the deflection at point B, okay, becomes 0. That means this is pushed back. So basically, please understand, okay, the first one is the given beam, and the second one we are trying to take the determinate beam, either the simply support or cantilever. In this case, we are trying to take a cantilever beam. Okay, case 1, I am applying the given loads. Okay, I have made the beam to deform by some extent. Okay, and then I am trying to push this deformed shape, okay, back to the initial position, okay, with an appropriate force R here. Okay, now once I understand this, I can try to relate, okay, the actual deformation at B, delta B, in terms of delta B1, which is nothing but the deformation at B due to given loads, okay, plus delta B2, again with appropriate sign, okay, which is nothing but the deformation at point B, okay, due to the reaction, okay, at B. So a simple equation relating the three deformations would be like this. So actual deflection at B equal to deflection at B due to loads plus deflection at B due to that reaction. This is what we call as the compatibility condition, okay, for a deformation, in terms of deformation, okay, is what we are trying to tell you. Now, we just try to look at this one. So, delta B is generally known. That means, okay, if there is no settlement in the problem, we try to say delta B equal to 0. If there is some settlement of 5 mm, we try to say this is 5 mm. Okay, so the numerical value of delta B LHS is known, which is nothing but the summation of delta B1 and delta B2. Now, coming to delta B1, correct? So, you can easily calculate this deflection, okay, at point B. Anyway, it will be taught to you in this particular semester in modules 3 and 4. okay, we'll be learning as to how to calculate the deflections, okay, in beams. So you can easily calculate a number for this. Okay, coming to delta B2, please understand, okay, because the force is unknown, this will be expressed in terms of the unknown force. So that means here, okay, you know the numerical value of this, you know the numerical value of this delta B1, but delta B2 is a function of the redundant force. We'll be expressing delta B2 in terms of some redundant force. So solving this particular equation, I can easily calculate the redundant force, which is nothing but the reaction at B. So once I calculate reaction at B, the reactions at the other support A can be determined using the equilibrium equation. I hope you have understood what you mean by compatibility condition for deformations. Okay, that means you are writing the additional equations, okay, in terms of deformations, okay, and the deformation should be compatible, okay, they should match, is what it means, okay, in this particular case, right. Now we'll try to go to another interesting discussion here, that is linear and non-linear analysis. Now what is linear analysis? In case of linear analysis, please understand the principle of superposition is applicable here. So what exactly we mean by principle of superposition? I think you have learned that in engineering mechanics. Okay, if I just try to take a bar, okay, right, apply some axial force of 10 kilonewton, okay, get the stress, okay, and then further apply a force of 20 kilonewton, okay, right, I get a stress. Okay, so please understand, I have taken a bar subject to 10 kN, same bar 20 kN, I got the stress. Okay, now please understand, if I take the same bar, apply 30 kN force directly, the stress will be equal to the stress due to 10 kN plus stress due to 20 kN. So that's what we are trying to tell you in superposition. So this is possible only in case of linear analysis. Okay, right. So let me just try to tell you what is a linear analysis. Okay, that means if the stresses that we are trying to talk about are within the proportionality limit, I am trying to show you that diagram. Okay, right, due to individual loads and also the superposed loads. Okay, then you can think of linear analysis. Okay, you can just try to solve the problem. Okay, using the linear equations. Okay, over here. Now, what we are trying to tell you is for multiple load cases, yeah, we can try to do the combinations. As I told you, 10 kN, you get the answer, 20 kN, you get the answer. Okay, then I can get the answer for 30 kN by just trying to take the summation of those results. Okay, now coming to non-linear analysis, right, this is relatively complex. So regarding the relation between the load and the deformations, okay, associated, okay, no longer is linear, it remains non-linear, and this could be attributed due to the material non-linearity or geometric non-linearity of the structure. So non-linearity arises due to two things: one is material non-linearity and the other one is geometric non-linearity, correct. Now let's try to understand the two things separately. Now if you just try to look at this, you are all very familiar with this. It's nothing but a typical stress strain diagram for mild steel material in tension. Okay, so if you just try to check here, so initially you got a linear straight portion and this linearity ends at point P. And further on, you got the yield points, upper and lower, followed by the perfectly plastic region from B to C, and then the strain hardening portion and the necking portion. All these things are observed if you are trying to plot the stress strain curve, okay, using the nominal cross sectional area. Okay, right. So, and trying to get the nominal gauge length to calculate the corresponding stresses and strains. Okay, now what we are trying to tell you in linear analysis is, okay, the stresses are well within this point. Okay, that means the stresses do not exceed point P. So whatever relation, that we are trying to talk about, stress equal to, okay, strain into Young's modulus. What is Young's modulus? It's nothing but the slope of the stress strain diagram. Please understand, this relation is not applicable, okay, if you are trying to consider strains beyond the strain of point E. Is it all right? Okay, so once you exceed this strain, you can look at the curve. The curve is totally different. You cannot use this type of relation. Okay, so this expression sigma equal to epsilon into Young's modulus is applicable only in the initial straight portion of the stress strain diagram. Okay, and it's related as sigma equal to epsilon into Young's modulus. Please understand, epsilon is nothing but strain. How do you get strain? Okay, change in length by initial length for a simple problem. Okay, so delta L is measurable, right? Initial length is measured, it's also measurable. So you can easily calculate the strain. You just try to measure the deformation, then calculate the strain and multiply it by the material property, that is Young's modulus, that will give the stress. Stress cannot be measured, okay, it will be calculated, okay, as strain into Young's modulus. And to convert strain to stress, you are multiplying by Young's modulus, provided, okay, the stresses are within the proportionality limit. So, that means it is in the initial linear part of the stress strain curve. So, we are talking about linear analysis. So, please understand this very clearly. So, we do not want the stresses in the materials to exceed, okay, the proportionality limit. If you exceed that, okay, the curve is non-linear and we cannot easily calculate the stresses under such situations. Okay, now this is one more diagram, stress strain diagram, generally for brittle materials. And again, you can clearly see here, initially you got a straight part, okay, so 0 O to P, that's nothing but linear part, and then the curve becomes non-linear, okay, keeps on increasing, non-linearity keeps on increasing, okay, reaches the maximum value at point A, and once you try to deform it beyond point A, suddenly it's going to fail at point B, right? Okay, so the drooping portion is very small in case of brittle materials. So we are talking about linear analysis. Please understand, okay, you are well in this region. That means the stresses that you are talking about in the material, okay, is well below point P, and this stress, okay, whatever we are talking about is for the multi-load also. That means the body may be subjected to one load, two load, three load. So when it takes all the loads, the stresses should not exceed the proportionality limit. So normally we will have a cushion, okay, so that means the maximum working load, okay, will be normally kept well below the proportionality limit, okay, is what we are trying to say. Or we also say yield stress, okay, yield stress is considered to be the failure stress. So we define that as the factor of safety. The factor of safety is nothing but the ratio of the failure stress by the working stress, okay, and working stress would be much lower than the proportionality limit, is what we are trying to consider here. Okay, now coming to a conclusion about linear and non-linear analysis. Okay, generally when we do any analysis, okay, the solution techniques consider only linear analysis. That means we try to assume linear relation between loads and deformation. Load is nothing but we try to talk in terms of stress, deformation is in terms of strain, and we connect the stress to strain by that Young's modulus. Okay, so the linear relation is what we are trying to talk about. So non-linear analysis is more difficult than linear analysis. It is a very complex kind of a thing. Now coming to another interesting discussion that we are trying to make here, is the degrees of freedom. Okay, so what is degrees of freedom? Okay, it's nothing but the total number of independent displacements, okay, that exist in a structure. Okay, when you just try to say displacements, okay, it comprises of the translations, yeah, two numbers, one in x direction, one in y direction, and a rotation. Okay, so that means totally there could be a lot of movements happening in the structure. Okay, so we try to sum all the movements, possible movements that take place in the structure. You count and then try to tell that, okay, the total degrees of freedom of this structure is this many. Okay, that's how you are supposed to define the degrees of freedom. Okay, so it's nothing but the total number of independent displacements. Okay, that is translations, rotations put together at all joints, okay, in a structure. Okay, what is translation? Translation is linear movement, okay, movement of a point, straight movement, say horizontal movement, vertical movement. Okay, so this is nothing but the translations. Okay, x and y, translation movement. Rotation, yeah, it's something but it rotates about the point, okay, right, about a point, about an axis. Is it all right? Rotation. Okay, so three derives is what we are talking about. Okay, three different types of degrees of movements is what we are trying to talk about. And important, degrees of freedom is also called as kinematic indeterminacy. The one that we talked about earlier is static indeterminacy. And if you are talking about indeterminacy based on the movement, okay, then we define it as kinematic indeterminacy. Right, so kinematic means movement. Okay, what are the movements that we can have in a structure? Okay, static indeterminacy. Okay, basically it depends on number of reactions. Okay, that we have here, unknowns. Okay, generally we try to link the indeterminacy. Okay, in that particular form. Okay, and please understand, I just mentioned that there are two methods of analysis: the force-based method and the displacement-based method of analysis. When we are solving indeterminate problems in force-based method of analysis, okay, please understand, we will be calculating the degree of static indeterminacy. However, if you are doing the same problem in displacement method, please understand, we will be trying to calculate the degree of kinematic indeterminacy. So, force-based method uses the static indeterminacy, okay, to calculate the indeterminacy. Whereas displacement method of based method of analysis uses the degrees of freedom or the kinematic indeterminacy to calculate the indeterminacy of the structure. Okay, so the more the indeterminacy, the more complex, okay, is to solve the problem, is what you need to understand. Okay, now in beams and frames with rectangular configurations, that means all columns are vertical, all beams are horizontal. Okay, a simple structure like that. Okay, please understand here, all displacements are independent. Okay, generally all displacements are considered to be independent. However, if the frame consists of sloping members like this, okay, top gable, is it all right, bent members, inclined members, okay, then please understand, okay, some displacements are controlled by, okay, other displacements. So you need to be careful, okay, in such kind of structures. Okay, so eventually degrees of freedom means total number of independent movement we can have in a structure. Okay, now normally where do we compute these degrees of freedom? The structure will have many infinite points. All these points, each and every infinite point, okay, can move in x direction, can move in y direction, and it can rotate. Okay, so normally we are not trying to do like that. We try to calculate the degrees of freedom, okay, at nodes only, right, at selected points, right. And what is a node? We try to say all joints can be treated as nodes, correct. And what is a joint? A joint is a point where two or more members meet. For example, the junction of a portal frame or an intersection like this of a portal frame. Okay, they are all joints. Then supports are also considered as joints. Okay, the free end of a cantilever is also considered as a joint, okay, or a node or a point. Some problems, it's possible that the depth of the beam suddenly decreases, okay, between the two supports. That means where the moment of inertia suddenly changes, So generally we try to consider all these points and then identify the degrees of freedom, okay, and count all these things. Then we try to get the total number of degrees of freedom, okay, from which you can try to say what is the degree of kinematic indeterminacy. So as we were trying to tell earlier, indeterminacy two types, okay, static indeterminacy and kinematic indeterminacy. Force based method uses static indeterminacy, that is DS, and kinematic indeterminacy uses DK, that is nothing but the degrees of freedom. And one important thing that you need to remember here is, okay, give an example of a kinematically determinate member. If you just try to quickly recollect, we talked about two examples for statically determinate members. One is a simply supported structure and the other one is a cantilever structure. Okay, say for example, a simply support beam and a cantilever beam, okay, can be thought of to be examples of statically determinate structures. Now coming to kinematically determinate structure, like we just talk about a fixed beam, okay, one member, two supports, both supports are fixed. So when both supports are fixed, so please understand, okay, we cannot expect, okay, any movement to be present at both the supports, okay. So since there are no movement in a fixed member, we call it as a kinematically determinate member, okay, please remember, okay, statically determinate member, two types, simply supported, cantilever, kinematically determinate member, only one, that is a fixed beam or a fixed member, okay, this you have to remember, you should not forget this. Now let us try to some exercise here, where we can try to calculate the degree of static indeterminacy. So I think it's time we stop this discussion. We will try to continue the discussion right in the next class. Okay, we will try to take you through some interesting examples connected with the calculation of degrees of static indeterminacy for different types of problems, like it could be trusses, beams, simple portal frames, slightly complex portal frames, and also internal hinges. So we will try to do that in the next.